From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Internal Medicine Author Interviews, conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinions featured in JAMA Internal Medicine.
Hello and welcome. This is Dr. Eve Rittenberg, the viewpoint and online editor at JAMA Internal Medicine. Today, we're diving into the rapidly changing world of treatment for weight-related illnesses, looking at the new class of GLP-1 receptor agonists and how they affect the body beyond weight loss. As an internist, I'm faced, on the one hand, with enormous interest for my patients about these medicines, and on the other hand, with a lot of unanswered questions about how these drugs might alter the trajectory of health and illness. So I was excited to read the study that we'll discuss today that looks at the impact of GLP-1 medications on liver health. Our guests today are Dr. Fasiha Kanwal, a gastroenterologist and professor of medicine at Baylor College of Medicine. Dr. Kanwal is the lead author of an article entitled GLP-1 Receptor Agonists and Risk for Cirrhosis and Related Complications in Patients with Metabolic Dysfunction-Associated Steatotic Liver Disease. And I'll just add that MASLD is what we used to call non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. And we'll also talk with Dr. Grace Zhang, who's a former editorial intern at JAMA Internal Medicine and now a gastroenterology fellow at UCSF. So welcome, Fasiha and Grace. And I'll start with you, Fasiha. Can you tell us what made you interested in doing this study?
Yes, absolutely. First of all, thank you very much for inviting me with this conversation. As you mentioned, this condition, MASLD, Metabolic Dysfunction-Associated Steatotic Liver Disease, it is a very common condition. Every third person walking down the street potentially has MASLD. And it is the fastest growing cause of liver disease and its complications, including cirrhosis of the liver and other complications, including liver cancer. So it is becoming a major issue for our clinical care, for our patients and populations broadly, making it really important for us to find strategies to somehow prevent this otherwise rising tide of liver disease. And chemo prevention is one such strategy, but we really didn't really have any good, strong clinical trial evidence for chemo prevention of liver disease in patients with MASLD. And that is what led us to work on this study, focusing on GLP-1 receptor agonist as a potential chemo preventive agent.
And so when you looked at these medicines as potentially preventing complications of liver disease, what did you find?
We conducted a study of over 16,000 patients, cohort study using data from the Veterans Administration, looking at GLP-1 use. And we found that in patients who did not have cirrhosis of the liver to start off with, when they started using these medications, they experienced a significant reduction in the risk of progression to cirrhosis and its complications. In contrast, we also at the same time looked at patients who had already progressed to cirrhosis by the time they started these treatments, and the chemo preventive benefit was limited in those individuals. So it has really important clinical implications. These treatments have a chemo preventive role, but it's also important that these treatments are started earlier in the disease course, because that is where the benefit is, maximum benefit in that group.
Do you have a sense of why the drugs are effective early but not later on?
Yes, I think this is a very good point. This has to do with the pathophysiology of the condition. These drugs usually work by reducing weight, improving glycemia and inflammation. And I think those actions are more relevant earlier on in the disease rather than later in the disease course. Once cirrhosis sets in with fibrosis in the liver, the effect probably is limited. That's what the idea is at the moment. And some of the trials that are coming out, though there are smaller trials with few patients, they also support this notion.
Interesting. And I'm going to turn now to Grace and ask, so Fasiha has described some really important effects of these medications in people with diabetes and MASLD. Can you kind of put that in context for us? Like when we think about clinically all of these patients, as we heard, like maybe one in three people walking down the street might have this condition. Can you talk a little bit about how to put this in context?
Yeah, thanks so much, Eve, for having me as well. Like Fasiha said, so many people have diabetes, obesity, and MASLD, and diabetes and obesity are both conditions that really, really impact whether or not you have MASLD. So I think that in clinical context, we are using GLP-1s kind of off-label to really target diabetes and obesity, because those are what they are FDA approved for at the moment. And with the current randomized controlled trials out and with Fasiha study as well, we're able to also target some of the effects that they may have on liver disease.
And Fasiha, do you want to tell us a little bit more about how much of a difference in terms of preventing cirrhosis or complications these medicines seem to have in your study?
Yes. So there is an effect. We found about 14% lower risk of progression to cirrhosis. So statistically significant. But if you look at that, it's not a large effect. Important, clinically important, but not a large effect, which would also indicate, although these are promising agents, but we will have to treat a lot of patients to really get the benefit from these treatments. I also would add one more thing. Most of the patients in our study were treated with a combination of different GLP agents. We started with agents that were available a few decades ago, a decade ago, and then looked at more recent ones. When we parsed out the effect, we saw a stronger signal for the more recently available GLP-1s, which indicates that as these treatments get better, we probably will see a stronger effect with the newer treatments and with the dual agonists. So there is a clinically important signal, probably not very large signal, but clinically important nonetheless.
And do you think that looking at these newer agents is where the next steps in the field should be? Or are there other kind of next steps in the research agenda that you see as important?
Yes, I think it's a very exciting time. The newer agents are more effective in terms of their impact on weight, for example. So we can posit that they will potentially have a stronger impact on preventing liver outcomes also. At the same time, if there are going to be other therapies, we just got approved. The first liver-directed treatment for patients with MASLD got approved recently. So there is a possibility that patients who are on combination treatments with the GLP-1s and other liver-directed therapies could potentially have a larger impact. We do not know the answer to that question, but it is possible. So I think future studies and research should be examining some of these important questions using real-world data, just like we did.
Mm-hmm. And Grace, did you have other thoughts to add to that, or does that sound right to you?
Yeah, I think with the current trials out, we're not at a point where we can really talk concretely about how they really affect clinical events like liver decompensation, transplant, progression to cirrhosis. So that's why studies like this one are really important to give us a little bit of background as to what might actually be going on and correlate them with what we're seeing histologically, which are what the endpoints that the FDA has required. So I think, you know, in the future, we're going to be able to see some of these data in real time, maybe 4 or 5 years out, as we're able to see how they actually impact decompensation, progression to cirrhosis, need for a liver transplant, and ultimately mortality, like we're seeing already with cardiometabolic effects.
Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it, how these medications have effects in so many organs, systems, so many sort of conditions as we think about their effectiveness for health and illness beyond just the weight effects. I wonder if either of you, given that what you've said about this state of knowledge being incomplete yet, but we have these exciting signals from this study and from some others, do you have a clinical pearl that you would want to share with our audience? Like, what would they be able to tell a patient, or what would they advise a patient who comes in asking about these medicines and what the effects might be?
Yes, absolutely. I can start first, if you're okay with that, Grace.
Yeah.
So I think, as mentioned, this is an exciting time because up until recently, we didn't really have a way to counsel our patients in terms of medications. So this is, I think, an exciting time. Patients who have mast cell and diabetes, as Grace mentioned, who have an indication for GLP-1 receptor agonist, I think they should be considered for these treatments because of their multiple benefits for diabetes, obesity, and now liver-related benefits. So I think that's very strong rationale to discuss with the patients why these might have protective benefit, beneficial effect for outside of just cardiovascular, but also liver. One of the things that I think is important is to try to offer these treatments earlier on in the clinical course of mast cell. So that is one thing that I think we recognize with this study, how important it is to use these earlier in the disease course and not wait for disease to progress to a point where the effect is minimal and that might be point of no return. So I think those are the two important parts, counseling patients on these treatments, but doing it also earlier on.
That's a really important point. Thank you for emphasizing that. And Grace, anything that you wanted to add to that?
Yeah, I actually love that piece of your study, which really, really highlighted that this makes a big impact earlier on. And I think actually we see this a lot in liver disease in general, where, you know, we see some effects when we start to treat earlier disease, and maybe later as our therapies get better, we see that effect happen in cirrhosis. So I think for the general internists, who are the first touch point for some of these patients who are at the forefront and able to identify those with mast cell, I think it's really, really important for them to understand who should we be looking out for and how should we screen the patients that we have high index of suspicion for mast cell. And I think current guidance released about last year really highlighted those with type 2 diabetes, those with obesity and comorbidities, those with moderate alcohol use, and those with first degree relatives of a patient with cirrhosis due to mast cell are some people to keep in mind to screen in your practice. And really, the best screening test that we have is the FIB4 test, which is just a calculator, and you can do some blood work, and it has a pretty good negative predictive value for ruling out advanced fibrosis. So I would really start there. And if the cutoff is less than 1.3, then you can continue to monitor. But if it's greater than that, they may need additional testing to really be able to figure out if they have advanced fibrosis or not, and possibly be connected with a hepatologist and gastroenterologist.
Thanks for that plug for the screening, for the role of general internists in screening. I remember when I found out about the epic dot phrase for FIB4, and I was so excited about it because it is so easy. And it's nice to start thinking about how you identify patients who might benefit from these screens, these medications, these treatments. So Fasiha, did I hear you about to start saying something?
Yes, I was very happy to hear Grace talk about that. Because really, I think the main points are we need to find these patients. They're there. As I mentioned earlier on, there are lots of patients who have this condition. And one of the reasons that the movement was slow in terms of finding these patients, or the recommendation was relatively weak, just because we didn't really know what to do with them or what to recommend. But now with these treatments and these data that are now emerging from different studies, do offer an opportunity to offer these treatments to the patients. So I think that's also one of the reasons why it is important to screen, risk stratify, because now the next step in the care pathway is here, which are these treatments.
That is such a wonderful note to end this conversation on. And really want to thank you both for being here. I'm Eve Rittenberg, and I've been speaking with Dr. Fasiha Kanwal and Dr. Grace Zhang about GLP-1 medications and their impact on preventing cirrhosis and mortality in people with metabolic dysfunction-associated steatotic liver disease. You can find a link to the articles in this episode's description. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.